Hello, welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. I'm the RPG chick, and we're going to have to roll again. I only got two votes, as usual, last episode, and both of those were voting for, well, different things. It was a vote of where to go, so just a reminder, guys, if you can please leave your votes at the end, I really do appreciate it. More than two would be good. I get more likes than votes, which makes me wonder. Yeah, but anyway, on a roll of a d4. 1 and 2 will be the road east, as voted, and 3 and 4 will be across the plains, as also voted. I got 3 going across the plains. I think we've been there already, but we may find something different. Okay. You return to the road. The afternoon is starting to draw on. Really, the day is passing a lot quicker than in previous installments. Across the plain. Okay. Wasn't expecting that sound. You leave the well-paved road and cut across the now windswept plain. Days are short out here. The evening is drawing in. Yeah, I'm noticing that. You crest a low rise and look down across the barren wastes, offering something of a view. Now, I would like to look at all, well, three directions provided here. As long as we don't end up being in the middle of the night by the time we're done. Looking north, a deep, dark gash seems to cut across the land. It must be a fissure of some kind. To the south, you can make out Althera's tree lifting dead branches to the gray sky. East, the road makes a loop past the foothills of the Badubak Ridge, passing an unusual spiked rock formation. And that is all there is to see. You march onwards. Towards the cliffs, we've been over there. I'm gonna go to the road south. Might end up just heading east anyway. I get that sound every time. You walk on across the prairie until you join an old road. Clouds rumble as they roll across the dimming sky. It'll be night soon. The road is a broad, serviceable highway designed for heavy wagons or marching armies. On either side, grassy fields lead into the distance. From behind you, a voice says, "Excuse me." Turn around. Do we hear this voice before? Oh. You whip around to find a small boy holding a sun jewel in his hand. He pushes it toward you. I'm going to choose none of the above for a moment and check my items. I had 2. Had 2. He has my missing sun jewel. Where did you get that? You dropped it, the boy said. Thank him. You nod your head and thanks. The boy smiles and puts a sun jewel into your hands. Then he steps back and waits for something. Talk to him? I don't want to give him a reward. He probably stole it from us, and they gave it back to us. Unless that's the thing that the... somebody bumped into me by the whirlwind over there. But they stole something else, though. They stole the thinking cap, or whatever the hell it was. You squat down onto your ankles to be more at the boy's level. He is clearly local and likely to know a lot about the area. What can you tell me about the towers? You ask the boy. The beacons? The boy shrugs. Why are you interested in them? They are most strange. Just magic, the boy replies, with a sulky shrug. A sulky shrug. How might I cross Lake I always have trouble saying that. Ilklala. You continue, thinking ahead. You can usually get a ride on the fishing boat, the boy replies, if you don't mind dawdling while they catch their fish. The boy is starting to look twitchy. Where are you from? Kare, he replies, to your surprise. But I run errands, all the way to Tin Pang sometimes. The boy hops from foot to foot. And where is Tin Pang? Across the marsh, over the bridge, near the lake, he answers. You can run there in about a day. The idea that this boy can cross the entire of the backlands is startling. This is the most dangerous land you know. The boy smiles quickly. I have to go now. I really have to go. Did he use the bathroom? Why? I'm in a hurry, he answers, uninformatively. Without another word, I skipped ahead. Without another word, you turn and move away. The boy takes off at a sprint and disappears in the other direction along the road. It is only later you realize that he somehow swiped a sun jewel from your pack. You continue to walk. God damn it. So he took the thing back again? I still have one. I guess as far as things he could take, it's not the worst. The Mart. I don't think we've been over here. So I think if I can, I'll go here and then along the road. I wonder if you can find food. You follow the ancient road back to the edge of the cliff. Another night begins. You should try to find a place to sleep, especially after so long walking with an empty belly. Low rocks and small fox caves might provide good shelter for sleeping. Yeah, I guess so. Gonna lose stamina, right? I mean, I have a blimberry juice, but I don't think that works the same as food. Rest here. You curl up in a small cave to sleep. You have not yet eaten today, but you have no provisions and only a single vial of healing blimberry juice. I'm gonna save it. You close your eyes and let your tiredness overtake you. You are protected here, and your rest is untroubled by dreams. Sleep will not heal you if you have not eaten. Okay, but I don't need to heal. The base of the cliff. Day 4. During the past day, you met Shadrach the Hermit. That's about it. You clamber out of the foxhole and dust yourself down. There's no way up the cliff face from here. The cliff face is covered with pockmarks and raised lumps, as though it was once ornately carved. But nothing now remains. You look back northwards. Yeah, gotta head to the road east. Let's make some tracks. We've pretty much covered this quadrant, this southwest quadrant. The road leads away from the shadow of the cliff. The air stirs a little, but a little cold. Still cold, but fresh. Sorry. The road forks here, with the main path sneaking up the mountainside to the east. Rocks have tumbled down the slope and all but covered the road. Look east. You cast your gaze east toward the towering Badubak Ridge. The main peak is lost in haze. At the end of the long, winding road that climbs the slope, stones shift and move underfoot as you walk. Wow. I hope we don't end up losing our footing or breaking an ankle or something. That would not be good. Mountain path. You begin to make your way up the mountainside. The day is likely to be clear and will be hot once more. The path quickly leads into an area of light forest, which covers the hillside with light shade. Animals scurry through the undergrowth, and birds fly overhead. It brims with life. From up ahead, you hear a repetitive beating sound. I would like to forage. Listen. The noise is loud and accompanied by the occasional cry. It seems to be coming from somewhere close, a little way to the north. Forage. You ignore the sound for a moment and leave the path for a few steps, pushing through the undergrowth and scouring for fruit or roots that might be edible. Eventually you find a small plant with bright purple berries. Oh, I can taste one, and if I taste one, I'm probably going to either gain or lose stamina. I can't gain. I can lose. Let me cast a spell. Quick, Batman, to the spell chart. What are we looking for? Psychic info? How? Reaching up to the stars, you create the magic and a calm voice speaks into your thoughts. It informs you that there are no secret entrances to be found here, then fades. I wasn't asking about that. What's the other one? How? The other one has to do about traps, I think. Detects trap. Do I even have that? Oh, I can't cast another spell. Taste a berry. You pick a single berry and place it in your mouth. The taste is bitter and sour. Huh? Eat it. You swallow the berry and wait. Nothing happens. Pick a handful of berries. I guess it works because it's in rations. You collect a decent handful of the berries. A few are squashed, staining your hands a bright blue color. Save them. You push on through the trees, using the beating noise to cover the sound of your steps. Probably giant wings or something. Follow the sound. I'll go through the forest. Well, this would be a short episode if I left this off now. Let me just see. Handful of berries, yeah. No further info. Let's follow the sound. I'm gonna end up finding some huge raptor or something. You leave the main path to follow the sound. The sun disappears from view as you step into the trees. On all sides, the ancient forest looms up. As the morning moves on, the wind begins to rise. You follow the sound of blows through the trees until you come across a clearing thick with knotted grass. On the far side stands a tall, wiry creature who wields an enormous axe. Whatever it is, it has not yet seen you. His attention seems to be focused on a nearby tree. Let's watch. You stop and watch as the creature raises its axe high and then swings it into the bark of a nearby tree. It is a woodsman, a tall, bent creature with eyes on stalks and long, pliable arms that it uses to swing between tree branches. By one tree is a discarded water gourd, presumably belonging to the creature. Well, is this thing friendly? I don't suppose I could find out. I don't have that option. I have S, though. Hey. Why do you keep moving? What? Stop that. Sense danger. You weave the constellations into a pattern around you, and a quiet voice begins to speak to you. It tells you that there is nothing to fear. The creature is a woodcutter clearing the trees, and he will not attack you unless he is provoked. With that, the voice fades. All right, let's approach the creature without provoking. "Greetings," you cry, striding out into the clearing. The creature turns to face you, swinging the axe carelessly onto its shoulder. It looks you up and down with its prehensile eyes. "Who are you?"
"I'm a traveler."
"Ugh," the creature replies in a deep nasal grunt. "And what are you?" it asks, when you are a little closer and it can focus on you clearly, reaching down as it speaks to pick up the water gourd and sling it about its neck.
"I am a human."
"Like the wizard," the creature replies, nodding. "I should have guessed, even if you do have less hair on your face. Hard to tell humans apart."
"What wizard?"
The woodsman uncurls an arm and gestures up the mountainside.
"The wizard," he says again.
Then it seems he can think of nothing more to say, so he lowers his finger.
Tell me more about the wizard."
"He's a..." The creature pauses for thought. Nothing happens. The creature closes its mouth. The woodsman points at your blue-stained hands with a claw.
"I see you've been grubbing in the berries. You know they're poison, don't you?"
"I feel well enough."
"Ah, well, it'll get you later." And he cracks a smile. "Everything'll kill you in the end."
Really. I wonder if they're poison to him and not just not me.
He, after all, doesn't know much about humans.
"What are you doing here?"
The creature regards a tree stump next to it.
"I was cutting down a tree," it replies.
"That's what I was doing."
"Tell me about the Seven Serpents."
The creature frowns. "I don't know anything about serpents," it says.
"I know about beetles."
As though on cue, a small insect crawls out of the bark of the half-cut tree, and the creature scoops it up with its tongue.
"That's a fine gourd you have."
The creature shrugs.
"If you like gourds," he replies, "I have about 22.
"Can I have it?"
"And why should I give it to you?" it demands.
God, I wouldn't do that. The last option, yeah, I would not take that.
"A gesture of friendship," you reply. The creature smiles thinly.
"All right."
It tosses it over to you.
"I have 21.
The woodsman lifts his axe once more.
"This tree won't cut itself," he declares, "so get out of the way so it can fall where it wants to."
He begins to chop the wood once more.
Leave the clearing.
"You have had enough of talking to this imbecilic creature."
"Aw, he seemed nice. He gave me a gourd," and turned to leave the clearing.
"Oh," it calls, "if you do go to see the wizard," it says, "watch your back."
"Why is it an imbecilic creature?"
"It was nice to finally meet someone friendly."
"Well, we did actually meet some other friendly people last episode."
"And technically the insect queen or whatever was friendly as well." You walk back through the trees and rejoin the main path. The trees echo with birdsong. You push on through the trees.
Alright, let's go through the forest.
The trees thin out, leaving only bare rock. The sun is hot now.
The summit. Oh, cool. What's this?
Nice! There's another friendly there. This is once perhaps the cone of a volcano. Now it is a wide, dusty stone bowl. But it has not... It is not empty. In the center stands a circular dwelling with a steeply pitched canvas roof.
Ground.
You glance around the wide pit of the old volcano, but there is little to be seen. No doubt the ash mixed in the dust is what makes the forest you saw on the slopes so lush and verdant. At least it seems fairly unlikely the volcano will erupt again. Cold winds claw at your skin.
The wind whistles across the top of the mountain.
Sure does.
The hut.
We approach. You approach the hut. Its walls are made of painted wooden planks, well set into the rock below. There is no temporary shack or a traveler's tent. A little thin smoke is rising from the stack.
Look around the hut. You walk a circle around the hut. To one side of it you find a smooth chimney of rock carved into the mountainside, leading as straight as an arrow to the valley floor far below. A few loose stones tumble over the sheer drop to the east and disappear. Knock on the door. You approach the door and knock. From inside, a wizened voice calls, "You're late. Stop wasting my time." Does that mean come in? I'm going to enter. Intrigued by the voice's words, you open the door and step inside the low hut. Now, the wizard that the woodsman was talking about, I don't know if he's the same wizard that we're going to be fighting, or some other wizard. But either way, he told us to watch our back. Inside the hut, your vision is lost in gloomy darkness. "Let us suppose," a creaking voice declares, or croaking rather, "that I am a sorceress, and you are a sorceress too. Do you know which of us is the more powerful?" "You are the wizard?" The voice chuckles. "You have been talking to my wood golem." There is a pulsing glow from somewhere across the room, and a moment later the hut floods with brilliant, dazzling light, so bright you are forced to turn aside, eyes watering. "I see you are not powerful enough to counter that," the voice remarks. The light finally fades to a more comfortable level. "I know the spell." "Darkness?" You hear the speaker rise and approach. A wizened, calloused hand is offered. "Welcome. I mean you no harm, as you can tell by my advanced age."
"I'll trust you to touch your hand. How about greetings?"
"Greetings," the speaker nods. In the light from her spell, you can now see the sorceress, a woman so ancient that her features are lost within a mess of wrinkles. She smiles as you look at her.
"I could be anybody under all these years, could I not?"
She remarks,
"I could be you."
"Who are you?"
She smiles. "My name is Bria. I am a sorceress once of High Zaman, though I left that place some time ago. You are welcome."
"You are from High Zaman?"
Yeah, the Archmage. "I trained in the fortress, as all true sorcerers of this land do," she nods. "You are worried, but please, the Archmage of the fortress was not always as he is now."
Ask about the Archmage. "Can you tell me of the Archmage?" you begin. She nods.
"Imagine, if you will, a country of great peace and prosperity, ruled over by a group of wise and powerful sorcerers and sorceresses. They tended the fields, managed the weather, healed the sick. They chose their leader by an arcane process. Any child from the land might become that leader and be taught their role from an early age."
"The Archmage is their leader?"
"That leader is the Archmage indeed, and when a new leader is found, the title moves on. A simple system, and an esoteric one. Imagine the Archmage as a peacemaker, teacher, but also a thinker, a discoverer of many secrets of the stars. He looked too far, this Archmage."
"What do you mean?" You continue.
"I was his farseer," she says. "He asked me to see further, deeper than anyone had seen before he sought to protect the land. So I looked 1,000 years ahead, but I will not tell you what I saw. It did no good to him nor to me."
She gestures you to sit down and takes a seat herself.
"Well, she said she will not tell me."
Ask about the Seven Serpents. "What do you know of the Seven Serpents?" you ask.
"They are the Archmage's servants," she replies. "But even they cannot travel the backlands without falling foul of its terrible curse. I see that you search for them."
"Do you know where they are?"
"I have seen a few things," she answers. "The Earth Serpent lies in wait, in a fissure near the great Lake Ilkala.
and a serpent of time. He is the worst of the seven, swift and all but indestructible.
Does he have a weakness?
He does, though I do not know it. It is a secret known only to the marsh goblins, if you can find them.
You thank her. She regards you with narrow, thoughtful eyes.
There's one other thing, perhaps, that you do not know about the serpents.
What is that?
You demand. Some creatures in this land are accidental. They are formed by chance, but not all. Some were always intended to be. Their design is visible in the wider world. The serpents are such creatures. Their existence was predicated by the placement of the stars themselves.
I understand.
It is a simple thing. The stars are the source of all magic, and the magic they provide defines us. There are spells for strength and speed and sleep, for death and fire and thought, and these are things all life shares.
What has this to do with the serpents?
She leans forward, eyes shining. There is a spell in the stars for these seven serpents alone. Consider that. The universe up there has aligned itself for their existence down here. Do you know the spell?
Tell it to me.
You demand. It will give you no advantage on them, she says, but it may yet be useful to you. She traces three curved lines on the tabletop. The spell is woven from three stars, from Sa, Sasara, and Sifax, and it requires a ring to shape, a ring carved in the shape of a serpent.
Where might I find such a ring?
I had one, she replies sadly, though I am not sure what I have done with it.
What does the spell do?
It will force the serpents to speak, to answer your questions. It will not control or destroy them, but it may yet be of great assistance.
You thank her. The SSS spell has been added to your spellbook. The old woman stands suddenly and goes over to a side table. Tea? That's funny. I'm going to add that here on the end. SSS. Force. It's not really like speak with animal or speak with serpent, but force serpent to speak. Okay, so added. Thank you. She nods and boils a pan of water by holding it between her palms for a moment. She drops a pat of goat butter in it and stirs around, and then pours out two ceramic cups. That's tea? Goat butter and water? Wait for her to drink. Swap the cups. She's gonna see me do it. You take the cup in your hand and watch her carefully. She catches your eyes and laughs.
Concerned?
Perhaps, you reply.
Very well, she replies,
and she leans back and sips from the cup.
Swap the cups. Drink mine?
Oh, I gained... Nice. I gained at least two. Well, I gained two, because that's all I can get. You lift the cup to your lips and drink deep. It is warm and rich and refreshing. Ask about herself. Tell me more of yourself, you ask, sipping at your tea. She seems almost to blush, ancient veins lighting up for a moment like a blown coal.
There is little more to know. I lived in the fortress for most of my life, but came here in my old age.
She winces suddenly. Hot tea is dripping from a crack in her teacup.
Cheap pottery rubbish,
she grumbles, digging up a small pot of glue from a box and repairing it. She leaves the glue pot on the table.
Oh. Should I just take it? Can I ask her for it? Why can I only take it?
I'm not gonna take it. Don't piss off sorceresses. I know I can use it for a spell. But, I wouldn't just take it from her like that. Glue. Glue, glue, glue. I don't know. Where's the glue?
Vial of glue for web spell. Gum. Tell me of Manping, you ask. She shakes her head.
There would be no use, she says. When I was there, it was a place of great peace, an observatory for the watching and better understanding of the stars. We called it the Fortress of Sorcerers, but it was not truly fortified. Now, it is quite different.
She stands.
I am tiring of you. You should go, she says bluntly. But first,
she raises a finger and points.
One more thing, the woman adds. If you are traveling to High Zaman to face the Archmage, hadn't you best know a little of the higher functions of magic?
What are they?
Magic is drawn from the pattern of the stars. Starlight can be shaped to alter our world, like hooking the threads of a tapestry with your fingernails. But for every bend in one direction, there is an opposite bend. For every one magic, there is another that undoes it.
Spells can be countered with other spells? You exclaim?
Just so, she replies.
Can you teach me?
It can take a lifetime to discover the pairings and to master them, but I can show you something simple.
She raises a finger adorned with a wide collection of rings. One, made of green metal, begins to pulse. But she does not fire right away. She is giving you a moment to react.
Well, how the hell am I supposed to counter it? I don't know what it is. Force field? Invisible wall? What is she? Green. Green is like the green wig that, like, can take control of people. Should I cast a tech trap? Or psychic info save us escape? Protection from magic.
Run for the door.
Oh, getting the hell out of here.
We don't have protection from magic. We have... what's Faf? I've used that before, too. Oh, force field, yeah. Dumb, which is... dropping an item. She's not gonna drop it, it's around her finger. Slow spell? That's a lightning bolt. Zip. Oh! Requires a green ring. She's gonna cast teleportation on me? How do I stop her from doing that? Naturally, this would never happen. Invisibility, which we don't have a pro ring. Talk with animals. I thought it had to do with green, was all mind control. That's a spell that requires the glue. I did that already. DOZ is slow. How How do I stop someone? I don't have the option for the how or the... Okay, I'm gonna ask her. What do? You demand.
Counter my spell of teleportation, she insists. I have already given you the clue as to what spell you need.
Her ring burns with green light. You have mere moments. You have?
I don't think drawing my sword is gonna do much.
Well, I'm not sure if this force field would work. You cast a spell forming a shimmering force field around your body. You should be protected from all but the most serious injury now, but the force field does not protect you from the woman's spell. Something strikes you, and a moment later you have found yourself outside the hut once more. Three new clues and another clue has been updated. Okay. You are back outside the hut. Chill winds slice at your cloak. There's a strong and generous magic here, as often occurs high up. Alright, let's look at these clues before I do anything. Seven Serpents' weaknesses. Seven serpents threaten your journey, for they carry a message that will warn the Archmage of your coming, but each has a weakness that, if discovered, will allow you to destroy them. Well, I knew that. Are serpents' whereabouts? Hiding in a fissure lake near Lake Ilklala. The marsh goblins know a weakness. The weakness of the Serpent of Time. Well, okay, tell me what could have countered that. Oh wait, it's an option, I can't just walk in there. Return to the hut. You attempt to open the hut door once more, but it will not budge. It seems the old woman does not wish to see you again. Perhaps you are bad luck. Alright, knock spell. I want to find out what's the counter to that spell. Knock is, dop. Wait. I don't have D. Oh, damn. Well, I would so cast a knock spell right now, but I can't. A few stones clatter away over the eastern slope. What's this? Oh. I see. Serpents. The pass. Okay. What is this? The chimney? You approach the chimney in the rock cautiously. It is not quite a vertical drop, but it almost is. The ground seems to be hundreds of leagues below. Look at the chimney. Looking more closely at the chimney in the rock, you notice a faint purple aura surrounding some of the stones near the top, and a few faint purple glows further down. Perhaps there is some enchantment on this flue, or perhaps it is simply a color the owner of the hut enjoys. Drop a stone down... Why would I do that? Oh, I lost stamina again. By teleporting me? Huh. Oh, no. I used that to cast my force field, sorry. Drop a stone down the chimney. I guess. You grab a nearby stone and toss it over the side of the mountain. It plummets just as fast as you might expect, careening and bouncing from the chimney's side until it explodes into particulate dust halfway down. So the chimney... Yeah, okay. Smoke pulses from the hut. You approach the hut once more. In the distance, you hear wing beats on the wind. Can I get around from there? The pass? Let me see. You head back over to the mountain pass. The strange light flickers at the edges of the mountaintop. You return to the path and head back to the hillside. The slopes. The slope is windswept. You trudge onwards. With a pop, your force field shimmers out of existence. The sun is beginning to lower, and the air begins to cool. The trees echo with birdsong. You push on through the trees. I think that's the only way down. I was going to make that a choice, but I don't think there is any other choice other than to go all the way around and see if there's another way. You climb above the tree line. The wind picks up as the evening draws on. Soon it will be dark. Where to? Huh. Yeah, I don't mean to make these episodes so long, but I'm waiting for a good opportunity for choice. You return to the chimney in the rock. Let's, yeah, try our fate, I guess. You step to the edge of the cliff and then over. You begin to plunge down the mountainside, knocking and scraping the rock surface on either side. You close your eyes and your heart moves up to your throat. Falling? Yeah, that seems like a great idea, actually. You fall at speed, a dead drop down the side of the mountain. The rushing wind snatches away your breath. Death is certain. You take a moment to arrange your thoughts. Rather fall. I'm arranging my thoughts in what? What does that say? The eastern face? Can I cast a spell from here? I don't have the option. Alright, I guess I'm going the eastern face. You're almost at the bottom. The sharp rocks rush to meet you. Oh, really? Then, a few heartbeats from a terrible death, your fall is suddenly cushioned, and you are brought to a gentle stop at the base of the mountain. Landed. You stand, heart still racing, at the bottom of the stone chimney, quite amazed to be alive, but there is no way back up that you can see. This is the eastern slope of the Battleback Ridge. In front of you stretches another plain, more rock than dust this time, and built of layers and layers of stone stacked like scattered papers. These are the Clatterback Steps, said to be the home of strange, half-human, half-simian creatures. I have no idea what kind of spell I would cast, so let's move on. You stride forwards. Is that... That's not another tower. That's a tower. And this is... some kind of... a home? A farm? Maybe a well out back? We've got some little tower with a a flag and looks like a village. Some huts. Oh. Purely, yeah, looks like a pretty small area. Compared to where we were, right? A little smaller. I wonder if from here we can get over there. Very cool. Because we didn't figure out how to cut across this bridge. Yeah, so, I don't know. Not of a very momentous choice, because we're probably eventually going to go to, like, everything in here that we can anyway. But, yeah. Been running for quite a while, so east or southeast. These are our options for votes for next episode, where to begin. So, leave a comment, please, down in the comment section. Let me know whether we should go east or southeast, which is actually northeast or southeast, but, well, it says east. So let me know what you guys think. Let me know where we should go. And see you next week. Hope to. And endure. And enduring, grow strong.